Once upon a time, there was a man named Solomon who built a mighty temple. But before long, the people of Judah turned away from God and began to worship foreign gods and idols. One day, God allowed the Babylonians to attack Judah and destroy the whole city, including God's temple. The people of Judah remained in captivity until one day, God raised up the prophet Haggai to inspire the people to get back to work, saying, "The time is now."
The time is now. Wow. I tell you what, the time is now to turn up the heat. Amen. Isn't that? It is cold outside. Praise the Lord for you guys being faithful and in some ways kind of, bold and risking, if depending on what neighborhood or what part of Greenville County you're in. I know that we have some people who got a little bit and some people who got a lot. And then I was noticing, I said something about on Facebook yesterday, somebody said Greer had 7 inches. And then one of our members here said, "Well, we got 7 flakes. How many of y'all were that person, you know? So I know we didn't all get the same thing. I think we got a little more ice than we did snow. But yesterday, the remarkable thing is, you know, we were wanting to obviously remember that the safety of our people are, that's kind of one of the most important things, obviously, when you're going through some kind of decision like that. But between 10 o'clock a.m. and 6 o'clock p.m., the roads really changed. And so it was a little easier for us to get here this morning, but I'm still grateful because I know in the southeast United States, if it even snows a flake, you can count on attendance at church being half, right? So just thank you for you guys being here because it really does show your heart for worship and desire to hear what God has to say to us during this time. I also want to just make sure we do recognize those who are viewing. I know we had earlier when the service started, we had about 70 people watching online, and so that's cool. A lot of those are part of our church family. Some of those are obviously people from other churches. Maybe their church doesn't have a service this morning. In fact, I know a couple of our really good friends just texted us, let us know they're worshiping with us. So that's special. That's really cool. And so would you just join everybody that's at home on their couch? Would you join them in worship this morning? Well, thank you, guys. We praise the Lord for you and you tuning in. Go ahead and turn with me to the book of Haggai. It's going to take you a minute if you're not familiar with it. Haggai comes after Zephaniah and after Zechariah, right? Actually, comes after Zephaniah and before Zechariah. And so you go to Psalms, take a right, all right? Head toward Matthew, and you'll get there. But I know this, too. It snowed, but it's also, there's some kind of game taking place tomorrow that has a lot of people traveling. I'm not sure what that is, somewhere down in Tampa, Florida. And I know a lot of you probably thought the preacher was going to the game, right? But not so lucky. We're not going to be going. We'll have the best seat in the house sitting right there watching on the TV. Pray for all the Clemson fans tomorrow, all right? It's either going to be the best day of their life or the worst day of their life. God bless them, all right? So I'm just telling you, bless their hearts. Amen. Can you all say that with me? Bless their hearts, really, all right. Go Tigers. There you go. Go Tigers. Go Tigers. I won't even say Roll Tide. I'm not even going to say it, you know. I'm kind of in a bad spot. It's better for my ministry for Clemson to win, I think. I'm pretty sure. And, I mean, we've already won 16, so who cares, you know, really? I'm sorry. I'm just kidding. Kinda kidding, but anyway. As you've turned to Haggai chapter 1, I want to remind you a little bit of background, what we have looked at. The time is now is the series, and that's, you know, it's a cute little framework for a series that we got borrowed from really another church, a great church, Life Church, with Craig Rochelle. But the theme is so relevant to the book as we walk through it verse by verse. And it's also extremely relevant to a new year because a lot of our aspirations, a lot of our desires, you know, the resolutions we make at every new year kind of can fall short if we don't really look at them from a spiritual perspective. Because it's easy for us just to say, well, I really want to do this or I want to do that. I want to be a better man or woman for God. But But if we don't really look at it from how do we accomplish that from a spiritual perspective, then we're going to fall short. We're going to fail. We've all tried to do things and not been successful in the past. We've all tried to live a better life, to be a better man or woman of God, and we failed. And so how can we make sure that if we start something for God, that we finish it? You know, it is imperative that we don't put it off. We don't say, well, tomorrow's going to be easier. Man, tomorrow always is easier, right? But the truth matters, the time is now. Now, last week we talked about taking the hard right over the easy wrong. It's easy for us just to do what everybody else is doing. It's easy for us to make a decision that in the short term is easier for us, but we know long term it's not what God wants us to do. And so we challenged one another last week on January 1st to this year really be intentional about taking the hard right, making the right decisions, even if it's the hard thing to do. Well, this week, I'm so glad you're here to dive into the next idea that begins in verse 13 of chapter 1 in Haggai, because here's the concept for today, and it's relevant to every one of us, and it's this. The time is now, and we've got to remember to persevere through discouragement. And so even in the midst of an exciting new year and maybe great goals that you've set for this next 12 months, and maybe you look at that map and you're like, this is a great map, man, for my 12-month progress, and I really think this is going to be fantastic. There are going to be times where opposition in the text, the Samaritans opposed the children of Israel rebuilding the temple. And so that opposition, you remember, from a background perspective, it stopped their building for 15 years. And so it's easy in our lives, even if we have a good desire to do what's right, and we go out and we have a good plan, and we start down the path, the minute we face opposition, a lot of us just buckle. A lot of us just quit. I mean, we just say, man, I didn't know that, you know, I was going to have people against me. I didn't know it was going to be tough. And so we get discouraged, and discouragement can easily lead us to really just derail the entire plan and not fulfill God's will for our lives. And so we want to make sure that we are not those people. We want to finish well. We want to recognize not only that the time is now, but I'm not going to quit. I'm going to start well. I'm going to finish well. Man, I could give you example after example of men and women who've been godly men and women who have lived a great life and have finished bad. That does not need to be you. That does not need to be me. Don't allow discouragement and despair and struggle and trouble cause you not to complete the task that God has for you. That is so important. And today, above every day, man, let's just focus on that as we look at this text. Several little bitty principles I want to give you before we look at Haggai 1. First of all, everyone needs life change. If we're in this room today, or if we're even watching by video, we need life change. For some people, it's just simply a spiritual life change. You just need to meet Jesus. I mean, it may be just that you need to turn your life over to Christ. You need to become a follower of His. You need to become a disciple of Jesus Christ. It may be that you're a follower of His, but you've not been as faithful as you need to be, and that's a life change that you need. Maybe that you need to grow more in His Word. You need to spend time, devotional time with Him every day. It's whatever those steps are. But then practically speaking, that may be finances. You need life change in your finances. We've talked about that. Education, health, marriage, parenting, all these things are practical, and we all know they're real. They're things that we stand in need of improvement in. We need life change in those areas. So I want to encourage you this day, don't settle for what you must do, but reach for what you can do. And I think that's what we're going to see in the text in just a moment is sometimes we just do what we've got to do, not what we're able to do. When I was a high school student, the main reason I was a bad high school student is because I only did what was required of me. Whatever was expected or whatever the line was that people said, or my parents said, you've got to get this, I would do that plus one. You know what I mean? I only did what was required. I only did what I had to do. And it was not until I was an adult that I really started applying myself and doing what I was able to do. And in your spiritual walk, there's really no difference. I think we settle into what we are able, what we must do. We settle into what people around us expect of us, and we settle into this, what's required of me? What are people beside me? What are my friends and family members expecting of me? And so that's our standard, instead of really what we are able to do for God. And so if we even look at every area of our life and to know that, man, before God, I should be. It's not to look around and say, well, I'm a better husband than that guy or a better dad than that guy or whatever. We need to say, how good of a husband, how good of a dad can I be for God? Not compared to someone else, not looking at someone else's expectations, but before God and what he's given me as a man to be and do, am I doing that? Am I being that man as well as I can? And so I think that's such an important question. Don't settle for what you must do. Reach for what you can do. It's easy to do exactly what it takes to get by. But I want to challenge you to do more today. You may have dreams of being a better father, a better mother, a better husband, wife, son, or daughter. But listen, the time is now. Stop allowing discouragement to shut you down. Stop allowing the devil to whisper in your ear and convince you that you're not able because of this deficiency or this inadequacy. Kick him in the face in the name of Jesus and say, this is the time. Don't say, this is my time. That would sound like a preacher out of Houston, right? I'm not saying this is y'all, right? Y'all don't know that preacher. I'm sorry. If I offended you, I apologize. Bless your heart. But it's not my time. This is not my time. This is not my life. This is God's life. That's why I must give him my best. This is not my time. It's God's time. And so this January 8th, 2017, a crossroads, a line in the sand for you. I mean, is it going to continue to be your time? Hey, it's been your time. It's been my time. Let's give it to God. Let's surrender ourselves completely to him. Then next little principle, God's always working in and through us to do great things. This is a scripture we've read many times. It'll be on the screen, Romans 8:28. This is so important. Listen, we know that in all things God works for the good of those who love him, who have been called according to his purpose. You see, God is actively working. That language is that God is actively working. It's in a process of working all things for your good, even bad things. Now, the key to that is it's those who have been called according to his purpose, right? Those people who love him and who are called according to his purpose. So if this is my time and I'm going this way, then guess what? I'm not answering the call of God. And so he's not working all things for my good. But if I am answering the call of God and I'm going the way that he has mapped out for me, I'm in the middle of his plan, then he is continually working all things, good and bad, for my good. And the reason they're for my good is because they're for my good in his plan. And even if that means my death, no matter what that means, it's for my good. What did Paul say? To live is Christ, to die is gain, right? And so in context and in perspective, when we love God and we're called according to his purpose, discouragement really shouldn't be on the table. Because we understand things in the context of God's calling on our life, this eternity, this eternal perspective on things that causes us to understand this is just a moment in time. This is just a small little dot. A small grain of sand on a beach of eternity, and we need to give it to God. So God's always working in and through us to do great things. And for the children of Israel in Haggai 1, it was to rebuild this temple. And they had failed up to this point to follow through, to finish. But then finally, we're going to see in the passage in just a moment that God will stir your spirit, but you will be tempted to suppress it. God will stir your spirit, but you'll be tempted to suppress it. Let's go ahead and look at Haggai chapter 1 and look with me at verse 13. And here's what it says. Then Haggai, the Lord's messenger, gave his message to the Lord to the people. I am with you, declares the Lord. So the Lord stirred up the spirit of Zerubbabel, son of Shealtiel, governor of Judah, and the spirit of Joshua, son of Jozadak, the high priest, and the spirit of the whole remnant of the people. They came and began to work on the house of the Lord Almighty, their God, on the 24th day of the sixth month. Chapter 2, in the second year of King Darius, on the 21st day of the seventh month, the word of the Lord came through the prophet Haggai, speak to Zerubbabel, the son of Shealtiel, governor of Judah, to Joshua, the son of Jozadak, the high priest, and to the remnant of the people, and ask them, who of you is left who saw the house in its former glory? Listen to this question. How does it look to you now? How does it look to you now? Does it not seem to you like nothing? But now be strong, Zerubbabel, declares the Lord. Be strong, Joshua, son of Jozadak, the high priest. Be strong, all you people of the land, declares the Lord, and work. So what are the two things he says? Be strong and work. Why? For I am with you, declares the Lord Almighty. Now, those are just eight short verses that we're going to look at this morning. But man, they do paint the picture. And the first thing we notice right there in verse 13 is that God does stir up our spirits. And I would even say that if you're a believer, you know this to be true. You know this to be true. There are times where God stirs up your spirit in a very unique way, and you cannot help but get excited and enthusiastic about what he's doing in your life. There has been a time when you felt closer to God than you do today, most likely. Now, for some people, you may be at that pinnacle. I mean, you may be at that point where you truly are walking with God in a way closer to God, in a way that you've never been before. But for most of us in this room, God has stirred up our spirit through our lives. There have been times where we felt God stirring our spirit, and there was more of us that we gave to him. Sometimes people say, oh, God, give us more of you. Give us more of you. He has given us all of himself, all right? So even if we sing songs that kind of, that's a little confusing. Sometimes when we say that kind of thing, the truth of the matter is, we get more of God by emptying ourselves of us, right? And as we empty ourselves of us, then the Spirit fills us. So it's not a lack of stirring of the Spirit. It's not a lack of God giving himself to us. It's a lack of us getting rid of us. It's a lack of us putting ourselves on a shelf. It's a lack of us humbling ourselves and submitting ourselves to his purpose and his plan. And so as he stirs us, as he stirs our spirit, we have a choice to make. We have a crossroads. Are we gonna yield to the Spirit of God and his stirring? Or are we gonna repress it? Are we gonna suppress it? And that can be fleshed out in many different ways. It could be a big life decision, and the Spirit of God stirs your spirit, and you know what it is he's calling you to do, but you say no. But it could be even as simple as the Holy Spirit of God actually stirs your spirit in a worship service. Oh no. God forbid, you know, that we express ourselves because of the stirring of the Spirit of God. And sometimes we even if the Spirit is not stirring us at that particular moment, we may look over and see somebody else that's just having a spiritual spell. You ever seen somebody just may see somebody having a spell? And if you don't watch it, your flesh will get up inside of you and you'll do it in the name of religion and self-righteousness. And you'll start saying, I just can't believe those folks just trying to point themselves out. Just trying to, man, we're just bringing attention to themselves. Man, you see, we get real judgmental when we get pharisaical. We get judgmental when we get self-righteous. When we start worrying about everybody else's worship instead of our own. We need to be like Clydesdales, seriously. We need to put on blinders so that the only person we see in worship is God. I mean, he ought to be the one we're worshiping. And what God's doing in somebody else's life, that's between them and God. It's not between you and God, or you and them. It really is between them and God. So we need to allow God to stir their spirit. Maybe they're more sensitive to the Spirit than you are. It may be that they've gone through something unbelievably terrible the week before, and God's just speaking to them, giving them healing. In that moment, something we can't understand because we haven't gone through what they've gone through. Anyway, that's just a little side note. But sometimes, yeah, praise God. Sometimes we need to remember that God does not call us to suppress his spirit. He calls us to yield to his spirit. God had a plan for his people, and he was actively stirring them up to accomplish it. 1 Thessalonians 5:19 speaks to this. I know you've heard it before, but Paul tells us, don't quench the Spirit. Don't quench the Spirit of God. Yield to the Spirit of God. Allow him to stir you up. Allow him to move in your midst. It is sad and discouraging that many times people will get more excited on a Monday night at a national championship game than they will about Jesus Christ forgiving them of their sins and giving them eternity in heaven. Jesus deserves more fame than Alabama. I'll say that first. Jesus deserves more fame than Clemson. This wasn't even in my notes. This is extra. I'm sorry, y'all. I only got one service today, so I got to get it all out, all right? But I wonder how our friends or our family members, which one do they think we love more? Our favorite football team or Jesus? Which do they hear us talking about more? Man, that's tough. I'm sorry. I need to get off of that. Wow. Which do they hear us talking about more? Our favorite sports team or the God of the universe that came in flesh to hang on a cross to die for us? Man, that's tough, but the truth of the matter is, see, we get so hung up on, in here we don't get stirred up. But we get stirred up about the stuff we're passionate about. We get expressive about the stuff that we love. So that's just extra. Sorry about that. Anyway, God will stir up your spirit, but you will be tempted to suppress it. Second, there will always be a reason to say no way. There'll always be a reason to say no way. When God calls you to do something, when God calls me to do something, it's going to be easy to say, I'm not doing that, man. No way. Forget that. It's going to always be easy to say no way. We have plenty of reasons to slow down, to shut down, and to turn around. It's kind of a choice we have every time. We can just kind of see things getting a little uncomfortable. Samaritans are coming against us. And so even though we're building the temple back, we slow down. Or maybe we just shut down the construction, man. We say, I'm not going to do it anymore. Or we just turn around and say, you know what? That's what they did. They said, 15 years, we're not going to do it. We're not going to work on this temple anymore. So we have plenty of opportunities to make those decisions not to be obedient to God in our personal life and in our corporate walk as a church. But remember, the right thing is always the hard thing to do. The right thing is always the hard thing. It's the hard right. But we often choose the easy wrong. Remember, we choose one or the other. You've heard the saying, it's lonely at the top. Well, there's a reason it's lonely at the top. There are few people who are willing to do what it takes to get to the top. Now, that's in kind of corporate world lingo and stuff like that. And I would say sometimes people do more than they should to get to the top. They may even be dirty, or they may even do things that hurt other people, or maybe they hurt their families and neglect their families to get to the top. But in spiritual terms, we know that it is similar in the sense of really to obey God, to do what God's calling us to do, it's going to be lonely. There's not going to be a lot of people who are willing to do what it takes. There's not going to be a lot of churches that are reaching people. I celebrate that we see people saved and baptized on a regular basis. That is uncommon in our day. It's uncommon. It's astronomical. I don't want to say it wrong. I'm almost positive. I should have looked at it this last week. But I think that we had 300 churches out of 2,100 churches in South Carolina. I believe it's 300 churches that baptized one or less. I think it was 75 churches that baptized zero in this state, just in Southern Baptist churches in this state. Now you may say, well, preacher, that's not so bad. You're talking about over 10% of our churches. 10% of our churches baptized one or less in this state. Now I don't know about you, but that's not acceptable. We can't be okay with that. And so when we look at that kind of thing, we can say there are many people who are not going to choose the hard right. They're not going to do the right. They're not going to follow God's will. They're going to do what's easy. They're going to choose to say, no way. I'm not going to do what it takes. The culture's going crazy. You know, people are rejecting God. So I just don't want to do what it takes to reach lost people. But then when we get to the next thing, we see we will always lean toward later. We'll always lean toward later. Man, tomorrow is always a good time to clean the garage. Amen? You know what I'm saying, guys? It's always the best time, you know, because tomorrow is always later, right? There's always a tomorrow. And I think a lot of ways that's how we've been. With things we know we should do, we kind of put them off to January so that every new year we kind of make resolutions and we make commitments to do the right thing. But we lean toward later. It's a natural thing. We follow a predictable pattern with our commitments. We start with great enthusiasm. Then just 1 month later, we get stalled out. Now, y'all are not going to believe this if I've never told you before, but I was the morning manager at a Gold's Gym. Did I ever tell you all that? I was the morning manager at a Gold's Gym. I know you're thinking, that's why he is so strong. Wow, I mean, it's, wow. Now it makes sense, right? I was the morning manager at a Gold's Gym. I was a youth minister and went to Gold's Gym every morning, opened up and all that. But January, the gym's packed. If y'all just joined the gym, I'm not even going to ask you to raise your hand. It'd be embarrassing, all right? But right now, a lot of you chose to jump on the gym, man. And in January, you're doing it. You're doing it. You got enthusiasm. I'll go and say last year, I was one of those, all right? Our whole family joined the YMCA for like 3 months. And got great enthusiasm. You're doing a great job. I mean, that first week, yes. Until it snows. And then the snow, probably if you're like most people, probably caused you to go and get a little snack food yesterday, you know. It's because you're going to be inside. I mean, you can't live on milk and bread, amen? You know what I'm saying? Milk sandwiches, right? But anyway, we start with great enthusiasm, but by the end of, you know, the first week or maybe the first month, maybe you stick it out for the first 3 months, but I think statistics I've seen before says that over 70% of resolutions don't last. But that means 30% do. So that means some of you are sitting there going, well, preacher, when I make a commitment, I stick to it. And I'd say, praise God for you. But it's very difficult, man. We want to lean toward later. We want to say, you know what, I'm gonna take this easy. I'll do this another time. It's just, I had good intentions, but it's just not as easy as I thought it was going to be, and so I'm going to quit. I'm going to challenge whatever it is, whatever you've committed to, stick to it, man. Stick to it. And I would say this, don't stick to it for you. If it's something you believe God wants you to get right in your life, stick to it for Him. I promise you, if you anchor your decision to Jesus and His love for you, it will help you. It will give you the motivation that you need. Maybe it's something you're trying to quit. Personal experience. If you're trying to quit something, if you will give it to God, you can quit it. But as long as you're trying to do it in and of your own power, even if you're trying to do it for God, you're going to fail. You're going to fall flat on your face. So we've got to do it in His power. But we're always going to naturally lean toward later. Now, God spoke through Haggai, and God said, ask them this. Look at verse 3. Verse 3, it says, who of you is left who saw this house in its former glory? I mean, this is the next two questions are I just really want us to focus. How does it look to you now? Does it not seem to you like nothing? Now, God was asking them basically, doesn't this bother you? Doesn't the state of my temple bother you? Doesn't the fact that everyone else has great houses and my house lays in desolate, doesn't that give you trouble? Doesn't that bother you? Does it trouble your spirit? Is that okay with you? I mean, that was kind of what God was asking them. Doesn't it seem to you like nothing? How are you okay with this? And you may say, well, preacher, how does that apply to us? Again, individually, it may apply to you because you may say, well, you know, all these things, again, that I've tried to do, I'm trying to make good commitments, I'm trying to do the right thing. I would say, again, are you trying to do the right thing because you believe it's God's will for you, or is it some personal thing? If it's something you believe is going to bring honor and glory to God, then you need to say, am I okay with the way things have been? Am I okay with it? Does it not bother me that my health is bad? Does it not bother me that you fill in the blank? Does it not bother? In the name of Jesus, it's important enough to make the change. And the time is now. Now, in the upstate, if you know, a lot of times it's easy to kind of lose sight of even why our church is here. But everywhere, I know everywhere you look now, you know, we have the logo. And some of you may be new and you're just like, oh, that's a snazzy logo, but what's it mean? It really is just a very simple logo that really tells a clear message that we are a church for the upstate. We want to not be okay with 1.4 million people living in the upstate and over 70% of them not being faithful to God, not worshiping God on Sunday mornings. Over 70% of them do not know Jesus Christ as their Savior. This is one of the most churched places in America. I know that. Some people say there are churches everywhere. But here's what I'd say. There are lost people everywhere. There are more lost people than churches. And if you put every single person, and let's say all of them got reached, they wouldn't fit in the churches we have, guys. They wouldn't. And so understand, we may say we got churches everywhere. We have more lost people than churches. And here's what I think relevant to this text. Are we okay with that? Are we okay with that? I mean, is it going to be, doesn't it bother me? Doesn't it bother me to know that over half of the citizens of the upstate of South Carolina are going to spend eternity separated from a loving God in a place called hell? That should keep me up at night, man. That I should not be okay with that. I should not be okay with that. And I believe God is shaking us, and he's saying, doesn't this bother you? Doesn't this bother you enough to recognize the time is now on this January 8th? And you may be like, man, this is what we get for being faithful and coming to church this morning. Woo! But listen, you're the ones that are going to make the difference. Can I just say that? I mean, listen, you're the ones that are going to care. If anybody cares in the upstate, you're the ones that are going to care. And so if God, man, if we could just open up the heart of our soul tonight, just open up the door and say, God, speak to me. Speak to me about why we do the things we do. Why should we care? It is because God loves every one of those 1.4 million people. God loves them. Jesus died for them. And we cannot be okay with them being lost. We've got to do everything we can to reach them. Two major causes of discouragement, and I've got to fly, I'm out of time. Two major causes of discouragement, comparison and lack of progress. Comparison and lack of progress. This is so practical, I've got to give it to you, so please just stick with me. Lean in for a minute. Comparison is so huge. Look, it's like he has a better job than me. He's got a nicer car than me. He's got a huge house. I hate my job. My car barely runs. I'm renting my house. Man, this comparison, right? That's the way we do it. Her kids wear the best outfits. Home-baked goodies, man. I mean, that girl's like Martha Stewart, right? She always looks like a model. My kids are barely dressed, socks don't match, forgot their lunch money, right? And they're flunking PE. How terrible is this, you know? Comparison. He's more successful. She's prettier. He's adventurous. She's so perfect. Let me just say, at some point, we have to have a balance of being committed and not running from what God wants us to do, because God does want us to be healthy. God does want us to do all these. But listen, at some point, we have to have a balance between embracing, look, being accountable for our needed improvement, but embracing who God has made us. Embracing who God has made us. Stop comparing ourselves. Stop comparing our lives to everyone else. Here's what comparison will do. You will live a discouraged life of uselessness. You will live a discouraged life where God does not use you because you've got so hung up on yourself you can't do anything for him. And so we can't be discouraged. We can't compare. Second thing, quickly, we often make the mistake of comparing our start with someone else's finish. And see, that's real easy for us to do. I mean, in our generation, Gen Xers and millennials are a whole lot worser. Worser. Did you hear that? That's nice. They're a whole lot worser. Did I say I'm from Alabama? No. They're a whole lot worser. All right. ADD, focus. All right. We often make the mistake of comparing our start with someone else's finish, and we start thinking, man, it's not fair because I've been at this thing for 2 months. I've been at this thing for 2 months. I've been working at this job for 2 months. I ain't got a raise yet. You know, the builder generation sits there and going, man, y'all are a bunch of spoiled brats, you know? Because, I mean, generations before us had to work so hard. They had to invest so much. Aren't you thankful for our older generation? I mean, I'm thankful to God that they have worked so hard. They sacrificed their lives in war so that we could have the freedoms that we enjoy. God forbid we become so selfish and self-absorbed that we expect at our start to be where someone else is at their finish. Oh, I wish I had the house he had. Well, he's been working on his job for 20 years. You know, you've been there 2 months, buddy. You know, I just think sometimes that's part of our problem, is that we look at it and we think we're going to work for two minutes and it's just going to be unbelievable. You know, everybody's going to show up, even in church life. I mean, we could do this. We could fall victim in this regard with this lack of progress. You know, I'm just going to be real transparent. 18%, you know, year over year worship attendance growth last year. And part of me is sitting here going, man, we should have grown more. We should have reached more. And I hope some of that's a good spiritual motivation that God has in our hearts, that we want to see more people come to Christ. But at the same time, we've got to understand progress takes time, and we're not in a 100-yard dash, right? We're in this long-term, long-term journey, right? God has taken us on this long-term journey, and we need to understand that this progress is going to take time. And in our own spiritual walk, in our own personal lives, we've got to understand that, man, it's not going to just be overnight. Diet, everything's about food. You may have eaten kale and almonds for a month and gained 5 pounds. Anybody ever done that? Man, that's terrible, isn't it? Maybe you're a Christian, but you still struggle with jealousy. You still lose your temper. Welcome to the human race. That's not good, but it's true. Not worth it, you may say. Marriage is going nowhere. Try to be a good parent. My kid's making bad choices. Have tons of friends, but feel all alone. Fight temptation, but can't beat it. You see, we get so discouraged because of lack of progress. We look around us and we're never satisfied. About a month ago or so, we talked about contentment. That's such a key here. We've got to be content with what God is doing, what God is doing in our lives, as long as we're yielded to Him. It's easy to just give up. And it's always easier to do the wrong thing. So again, remember, man, we have to make sure we don't make the mistake of comparing our start with someone else's finish. Do the work. And that's really what we have. The bottom line right here. What is God's message to His people when discouragement comes? Here it is. God calls us to be strong and do the work. That's what verse 4 says. Chapter 2, verse 4. But now be strong, Zerubbabel, declares the Lord. Be strong, Joshua. Be strong, all you people of the land, declares the Lord, and work. Be strong and do the work. Be strong and do the work. That's His message to them as they get back on the task that God has called them to. And so you may say, well, I'm going to get discouraged. It's going to take so long. It's putting one brick on top of another brick. I mean, the wall's not going to be built in 5 minutes. It requires step after step after step. If you're not seeing results, be strong and do the work. Put down another brick, one after another. Charge on in the name of Jesus. You may say, well, I just don't know what to do next. Keep doing what God told you to do already. Be faithful to do what God has already told you to do. And this is just a little side quote. I definitely feel like it's so true. Successful people do consistently what normal people do occasionally. And I want to say that in spiritual terms. Spiritually successful people do consistently what normal people do occasionally. So if you want to be a spiritually successful person, if you want to grow in Christ, if you want to be the man or the woman of God that God has called you to be, then you need to do consistently what normal people do occasionally. And I believe that is some great advice in relationship to how we can live this life in 2017. Galatians 6:9 says, let us not become weary in doing good, for at the proper time we will reap a harvest. Would you say that with me? We will reap a harvest if we do not give up. Man, don't give up. Don't give up. Don't give up. If you're watching today, don't give up. Charge on in the name of Jesus. In this scripture, the glory of God was returning to His people. The purpose was worth the process. The cause was worth the cost. And this principle holds true in your life. Choose the hard right over the easy wrong, and God will bless you. It will be worth it in the end. Let me pray for you. Lord, today in this place, there's no doubt we have a wide variety of people who have a wide variety of experiences. And Lord, none of us have the same circumstances. And so we're not going to even try to pretend for a moment that we all understand each other and what we're going through. But here's what we know. you understand. God, we know and trust you in all circumstances and everything we face that you can take care of us, God. And so we pray today you would help us in the midst of discouragement. I pray you would even, Lord, you'd stir our spirits, God. I'm praying for that for myself. God, stir my spirit. And I pray that I would not suppress it, that I would embrace it. God, stir the spirits of your people in this place today, the spirits of those who are watching at home today. God, stir us up, and I pray we will never be the same, Lord. We love you. Pray that you'd speak to us now in Jesus' name. Amen.
Stand together, please. Here's my